Hello, everyone, and welcome. My name is Stacey Avina, and I'm the Senior Marketing Manager for The Magic Show. And today, we're here to provide some tips on how to build your business at Magic. It's an amazing perspective from a true retail expert on how you can prepare for Magic and the great new brands, new tools that we'll be announcing during this call, and overall cool experiences that you can be part of on site. But before we start the presentation, I just wanted to go through a few housekeeping items. All phones have been placed on mute to eliminate any background noise. We do encourage you to send in questions online via our Q&A function, and we will address those questions in real time while the presenter is presenting. In addition, you will receive the full recording and slides about 24 hours after this call. So by tomorrow, you should be receiving an email with a link to the slides, as well as some other cool information regarding the show. We'll also be posting this to our educational portal that can be found on ubmfashion.com/education. And now I'd like to introduce our speaker for today, Mercedes Gonzalez. Mercedes is the founder and director of Global Purchasing Companies and author of the book Chronicles of a Fashion Buyer. And for those of you who've been to Magic before, you've most likely sat in on one of her presentations. Mercedes is praised for sharing tricks of the trade that everyday experiences have afforded her a more realistic perspective on the business, and she can pass that weight for you today, and you're going to be experiencing that today. In addition, we're also joined by Celeste Bohm, VP of Retail Engagement at UBM. She's going to be here to address any questions you might have as well. We also have a team of marketers here to address your questions online, so please feel free to use that chat function. Send in your questions, and we'll be addressing a few even after the presentation is over. And now what I'd like to do is turn it over to Mercedes.
Hi, good morning and good afternoon, everyone. I can't tell you how excited I am about this new magic experience that you're going to have. I want to start out with some really terrific news. You know, I have spent the last couple of weeks going over with some of our own retail clients across the country, and the numbers that we're getting and the margins that we're maintaining are absolutely phenomenal. So if this is your first trip out, you're going to find some really new and exciting things to add to the mix that you might already have. And if you're just thinking or just opening your new store, there is so much, a sea of, an endless sea of opportunity for you. So why are we coming out to Magic? The first top reason is to meet the brands. There's going to be over 2,600 brands from over 45 countries. Now, this is incredibly important because sometimes buyers get overwhelmed with how many brands should they have in your store, and honestly, the more the better, because I want you to buy, not by brand, but more as a fashion editor. So you're going to see that you're going to take a little bit from this one and a little bit of that one, and you're going to really make a unique product mix, a real curated area within your store. The other thing is that there are so many complementary, and I want to really emphasize that word, complementary seminars. And some of these people are really like industry titans. They've been in the industry for a long time. These are not like smoke and mirror kind of shady people, which unfortunately in our industry there is quite a lot of that. And there's also so much bad information. So these are the industry leaders that you're going to be listening to. And the best thing is you just walk in. There's no registration. There's no fancy setup. But I do want to warn you, some of the most popular ones, especially the trend forecasting ones, you know, some of these guys are literally the masters of the universe, get there early because they get jammed packed with people. And because of different fire rules and error, they can't have a lot of people standing up or sitting in the aisles. So the third thing I think is so important too is to actually talk to other people that are in business, whether it be that brand that you've been trying to get on the phone and you wanted to see, but they're just really impossible to get in touch with, this is where you're going to meet them. Or also other people in the boutique community or new designers that you could actually share different experiences. I cannot tell you the number of friends that I have met that we only see each other at this market twice a year. And I'm very also excited to introduce the app. So it's up, it's live, it's running. I have yet to download it. I was going to play around with it a little bit, but it's like fresh off the presses. So now you'll be able in real time, all of the seminars, the events, the sightings, besides following the show also on social media, which I also love what following the different hashtags and what people are saying. But this really is the ultimate show guide. And it also helps you plan in advance too, and also direct you. And this is really important because trust me, you will never do this amount of walking. So one of my tips that I'm going to get into is start getting on the treadmill, walking around the neighborhood, because it is exhausting how big this show is. And I just also want to mention, this is my 51st time going now to this magic event. And I've been going when it was just a men's show, and how I've seen it change and grow and everything else. And I have to tell you, when I walk through those doors, I still have to catch my breath because it is so big and overwhelming, and to stay focused is really, really important. So, hey, who's advancing my slides here? And I'll break down now the show by categories, and now this is going to be mostly what we're going to find. Actually, no, this is everything. So the show is broken up into different categories: men's, women's, footwear, children's, and sourcing. And there's also lingerie in here too that I just want to call out for a second, and women's too. There is every price point from, you know, advanced contemporary all the way to opening price point and what we call margin builders. And there's also a big section of sourcing. And of course, we're going to go through each one of them and let you know what the features of each one and what the benefits are to you. But this is kind of like the overall categories that you're going to find. The show hours, it opens up Monday, but it's only for sourcing, and opens from 12 to 6. Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday, it's open from, I'm sorry, Tuesday and Wednesday, it's open from 9 to 6, and Thursday, it's open from 9 to 5. And a lot of times, people will ask me, well, Mercedes, how many days do I actually need there? And I'm going to tell you the truth. You need 3 full days. I remember when this show was 4 days, and we couldn't cover it all, and now it's 3 days. So the Mandalay, which you'll see now that it's in two different campuses, there's the convention center, and then all the way across town is Mandalay, and that's also open from 9 to 6 and 9 to 5 on the last day on Thursday. So just keep that all in mind. Sourcing does open earlier and close a little bit later, so you might want to get to that first. So this is what the Las Vegas Convention Center looks like. And I know just even looking at this map, that little square inch is enormous. So wearing the right footwear, you know, really trying to work out a little bit and getting used and getting your steps in there. I think one year my record for one day in steps was 2,100 steps. So that's just to let you know what to expect. But you'll see that when we start from the south side, you'll see the sourcing. In the center, you'll see magic. And then all the way on the north hall, this FM platform. And don't worry, I'll tell you a little bit of tricks of how to get to all those different areas in the convention center quickly and efficiently. So let's talk about magic first. Magic, Women's Wear Daily Magic, WWD Magic. This is where you're going to find all the trends. This is where you're going to find the young contemporary. And again, don't just go by that word, young contemporary. It means so much more right now. It's not really an age group. It's about a lifestyle. It's the fast fashion. You're going to find some margin builder. You're going to find some of the brands like that you can actually private label. So I'll just give you a quick class on that. Private label literally means that we buy something and we change the label. So now I could already see a few eyebrows being raised. Yes, that is legal. You can't really protect design. And the idea is that you have to own the name that you're actually changing to. So, for example, you can't like change the name and put like Prada because that would be counterfeit and against the law. So as long as you have your own names, and I really feel that it's important, especially in a world where people are constantly Googling to see who's got it cheaper and faster and ship it to you for free, it's important to have a small area at least of this private label development that you can have. So there are a crazy amount of brands. Nanette Laporte, if you know Nanette's signature brand. It's a contemporary brand. It's very high-end. It's mostly made in New York City, and this is a lower price point, so it's a really great way of balancing that good, better, best price point within your store. Another favorite one of mine there is Recycled Karma. If you look at some of the more widely recognized brands like Free People, you'll find them in this area too. And, you know, even just talking quickly about Free People, you know, Free People was Anthropologie's private label. So Some of it was product development. Some of it was just private label that they changed out the labels. And they got such a really great curated brand together that they actually took it out of their stores and debuted it here at Magic. And now they sell it to the boutiques, and we know how the story goes. They have actually opened their own stores. So looking at these kind of case studies and realizing that this is where it takes place is really part of the learning experience that you're going to have too. So another couple of brands that I love here, Elan International. I promise you, I go to some of these really high-end resort hotel kind of places, and I know that they have private labeled some of Elan's products. So again, really great marketing opportunities, margin building opportunities, and just really taking a risk. And this is really important. This is what really separates us from the department stores and the chain stores and the online stores is the fact that we're flexible enough and feasible enough to be able to test something really bizarre, some really new trend that you absolutely hate. And it happens to me with every trend, every season. I absolutely hate it. And then when I start to see it in a couple of booths, I start to see it early in sourcing, I start to see it in footwear, in children's and men's, I know that it's going to be an important trend. And it's important to leave some of your budget for that kind of fun and newness. SM platform is the footwear area. And again, footwear is very competitive. It's very difficult. If you are a boutique that doesn't necessarily carry footwear, I do advise you to take a look at some of the international brands like Spain, the UK is going to be there, Brazil, which is just dynamite when it comes to their footwear. Turkey has some beautiful leather goods, and there's so much more going on. But look at some of these independent brands. Look at some of these international brands that you can't find on Zappos that you could have as an extension to an outfit or an add-on sale. And now I have this beautiful dress, and I have like the sandal of the season, or I have the boot of the season, or I might be carrying raincoats and I'll throw in like the galosh and fun printed colors of the season. These kind of little items that we treat more as an accessory, if you're not a full-on footwear store, is really important to complete that kind of lifestyle brand that you want. It is probably, in my opinion, and you know, I travel, I'm speaking to you from the country of Colombia. I probably travel to about 8 countries and 50 different trade shows a year, and this honestly is one of the biggest footwear shows in the world. So it's definitely worth exploring. It is broken down very easily to navigate by these different areas and neighborhoods. There's the Black Diamond, which is really the luxury footwear collection. And I advise you, if there's any of the brands which you could see online that you want to talk to, try to make an appointment early and not just show up at the booth, even though I do encourage that too if you can't get an appointment, because they are packed from 3 months ago. Cosmo, absolutely for everybody. These are your margin builders. This is your opening price point or your high end. If you're a different kind of boutique, you're going to find a lot of fashion here. Urban is the more bespoke and more, I want to say, it's a mix of traditional with a twist. It's not your like grandfather's like loafer. It always has a little touch of something. And I just came back from the men's show in New York, the project show. And, you know, it's about the add-on, too. It's not only about the footwear, but about the fancy sock and the colored shoelaces, which you'll also see in this area of the show, too. Camp is the more casual, more advanced contemporary lifestyle. Zend is where you're going to find a lot of like walking shoes and specialty shoes. Play is the kids area. And of course, On Point is the real fast fashion, trend driven footwear, which again, even if you don't carry footwear, this is a must stop for you too. So, sourcing, it's really close to my heart because this is one of the things that I feel like in merchandising school across the world, I'm not going to pick on any one school, they don't teach costing to buyers. It is so important to know what trends cost and perceptions of values are and technology and fabrication and the difference between one and the other. If you're not a designer or developing your own brand or doing private label in a larger quantity, and don't be afraid of quantities either, or doing some more product development, and you're just a retailer, walk this area for the knowledge. and becoming that credible expert. And when your local designer comes in and tells you, well, this dress is like $9 million, and you're like, hold on a second, sister, I know you're using $3 a yard fabric. You might even encourage them. And this is really where I feel like the beauty of our industry is helping the next client. And who knows, you might discover the next, you know, Alexander McQueen. So there are over 1,000 factories. They're coming from 26 different countries, and which I love because it's all organized by country. And you're going to see that countries are known for different things. Like, I happen to love Mexican and Colombian and Brazilian denim. I happen to love the embroideries of India. I love the technology, fashion forwardness, Pakistani fabrications. So everybody has like their own kind of thing that you'll discover by walking in this area. One of the other wonderful advantages is that a lot of these factories have small MOQs and they're coming from duty-free countries. So that's really important to understand the nature of things and getting things at a landed price. One of the other things that I want you to see is that Pantone and some of the trend forecasting people also have not what you're buying right now, which you'll see in some of the other displays throughout the show, but what's coming in the future, what's happening in 2020. And that's what the designers are designing for right now. We're starting to get our spring 2020 collections together, the colors, the fabrications, the silhouettes, and you'll get to see as a, you know, as a expert, as a merchant, as a retailer, what's happening. And one of the advantages I feel of walking this area too is that there is going to be a vintage section. It's called Morphin Paradox. And, you know, Alexandra is just absolutely lovely. She knows her things. She knows her, like, fabric history, her silhouette history. She could walk you through a lot of things. And there's a little bit of instant gratification. You could always buy one of the outfits for, let's just say, quote-unquote, inspiration or going out, you know, to the casino that night. So there is a lot here that I feel is important. And even understanding the technology when it comes to the different sewing machines and technologies, and you'll see how much of this is actually now automated by robots. And there's actually, I think Bob Berg, which runs part of this, told me that they're a micro factory that from concept on a computer screen all the way to printing just takes like a half an hour to cut and sew. And there's going to be a live demonstration of that too, of those micro factories. So the sourcing for footwear now has changed, and it's in this level too. So if you're planning on designing your own footwear, or you're already a brand that does like really beautiful sunny printed dresses, and you want to do a little skippy that kind of matches back to the printed dresses that you're doing, this is the place to go to. And I just want to call out one more thing too. This year, Magic and Sourcing and all the other shows fall on Chinese New Year. So even though China is represented here as one of the countries that you're going to see, I really don't feel like that's going to be the impact of the show, which is really kind of disappointing because there's so much going on with that. But at the same time, every yin has a yang, and this gives you more time and opportunity to visit some of the other countries, especially the Latin American countries, the Brazilian countries that have such a strong presence at the show too. So Mandalay. So now we're going to go completely across Vegas. All the way on the other side, I'm going to tell you how to get there efficiently and quickly without too much fuss in a minute. But I do want you to give yourself at least an hour, especially if you're planning a seminar or you have an appointment all the way on the other side, just to give yourself an hour so there's no stress factor with that. So as you see, it's laid out. You have Magic Men's, you have Pool Project, you have the Tents, you have Project Women, you have Curve, and you have Stitch. So all of these, including some really exciting brands from Montreal that will be exhibiting at Project, are going to be in this Mandalay Convention Center. So, Project. First, I also want to welcome and just really congratulate the whole company on Lisette Chin. She is, you know, beyond words, just really brilliant and a visionary in her merchandising of the different shows. And she's taken over Project. And you're going to see a real freshness. You're going to see some forwardness. You're going to see some new brands that haven't been there before. It's all broken down by neighborhoods. So there's Market at Project, there's District, there's Now. And all of these things really have their own kind of personality. Of course, they all have their daily happenings, which the app will tell you where to find a whiskey, where to find some coffee, where to find a snack, where to network with some bloggers. So all of that is going on within the different the neighborhoods. Some of the brands that we're talking about now is like the Pulse of Individuality, Ibiza, A Pair of Thieves looks absolutely amazing, Spray Ground. So all of these brands, and again, I just want to say that some of the really important brands, you might want to reach out before we go out to Vegas to make sure that you could get an appointment. The tent is the most elevated, contemporary, and by elevated, that's code for expensive. This is where you're going to find the high fabrications. These are what you're going to find in the really niche boutique, high-end boutiques. This is what you're going to see, like Barney's Inspirational. And one of the interesting things that they have in this area, too, are men's accessories. And that, I don't want to say that it's advanced contemporary price point, at a more accessible or aspirational price point, but men's accessory always just sell, and it's probably one of the hardest things to find and to really be able to coordinate back to the lifestyle branding that you want in your store. So Magic Men's is the more kind of traditional brand that you'll find. You know, there's a lot of, it's also where you'll find like the Big and Tall, if that's your niche market. This is also where you'll find like your church men's clothing, your traditional shirt and tie, your blazers, your jackets. And but there's also more relaxed related separates that you'll find in this area too. Project Women's, again, it's, you know, there's denim, there's newness, there's exclusivity with some of these brands that really protect you and don't sell everybody in your neighborhood. This is where you probably want to bring in that 20% of the fashion that's really on trend, that you're going to see in editorial, that you're going to see in all the magazines. Just to also, even if it's not the strongest part of your business, you have to have some of this in your store too. And one of the other things that we're finding, and you're going to find in this area too, all of these little like lifestyle supportive brands, some wellness products, some homes, some gifts, some stationery. Stationery just absolutely flew out of the stores during holiday. There's a few people that have like tabletop. So all of these little add-ons that you kind of coordinate with the same aesthetics of the store. And I know like sometimes you just feel overwhelmed, like, oh my gosh, I don't want the store to look like a big giant flea market. But this is another thing that I want you to do while you're at the trade shows. Look at the displays. Look how people are putting their product out. Even if it's not a product that you buy normally or you have other resources for it, how did they display it that when you're walking by, you actually stop to look at it? So all of this kind of reconnaissance information, all of this intel that you're getting, all of this consumer behavior that you're getting is really so important and really one of the fundamental reasons why you cannot shop for your store online. It has to be at these trade shows, specifically Project, you know, Magic, out in Vegas, where you could touch and feel and negotiate and have exclusives or gift with purchases. This is where you get that kind of business done. It's not on the phone and it's not online. So Pool trade show, again, very close to my heart. There's so many independent, young, new designers that come here. And I just love, like, over the years, I've seen somebody start out as a small accessory line or a t-shirt brand, and they've grown to these full collection, and they grow up and they move into Pool, into Project or Project Women. And it's just really fantastic. And the nice thing about it, too, is what I like to do, there is a small area of cash and carry. I always like to post like a little teaser on Instagram, on Facebook, like, hey, you know, I'm getting this in. What do you think? People actually text me back and they're like, oh, no, Mercedes, you have to save me one. Or I love that. Does it come in another color? Don't forget my size. And that also helps me, one, create excitement back at the store, and two, guide me with what actually the consumer wants. So this kind of information, this kind of real-time strategy is really important to play with, too. So Stitch is another area that you're going to find out at Mandalay. If you were looking for extended sizes, bigger sizes, plus sizes, this is where you're going to find it. You're going to find more related separates. You're going to find more casual looks, more flowy, easy kind of to wear. You're also going to find what we call like the global fashion, like Johnny was. You're going to see them there. Elliot Lauren does very well with us too, and we've been carrying them for a very long time. So, and two hard things to find, a decent pair of pants. This is always where you're going to find them too. So we love this area of the show. and children's club. So even, again, if you're a traditional children's store that has boys and girls and accessories and everything else, this is a no-brainer. But for most of us who have boutiques, this is not a bad idea just to do a really quick drive-by. And I just want to go back to one more thing, too. Over at the convention center at Young Contemporary, a lot of those brands started to do some little girl clothing, too, or some tween. And during different times of the year, like Mother's Day or, like, you know, wedding season, all of these mommy and me looks, they do terrific in the store, too. So even if you're not a traditional children's store and you just wanted to add on a couple of dresses for spring, a couple of dresses for holiday, a couple of dresses for social occasion, this is definitely something that you want to consider in your store too. So Curve, this is the lingerie area of the show. You're going to find a lot of swimwear this season. You're also going to find some resort because we're getting ready for that market that comes early before we do the spring summer market. And again, even if this is not a strong category for you, I do advise you to stop by. Even if you just buy impulse items like little Costa Bella panties that you can do for a certain price. They also have fashion forums will be there who does like the fashion tape and the nipple covers and the bartenders and even like the little basic shapewear. And I'll tell you, nothing closes the sale better than when you can offer the customer that right foundation or that nipple cover or whatever it is to close the sale. Because not only have you closed the sale on that item, but you also added on one more item to the ticket. And that's really important when you think about the bigger picture of how we do business. So the Magic Seminars, again, there's dozens of them going on every day at the same time. So I do advise you to go on their website, and here's like a screenshot of how to actually find it on the website, and just take a look at the different trend and how-to seminars. Of course, I'm on this list. Thank you very much, guys. Global Purchasing, we have the Welcome on Tuesday at 9 o'clock, just again to kind of guide you a little bit and give you more of a crash course on how to buy and how to navigate. We also have the Basic Retail 101 on Tuesday. There is the High Snobbery and the Fashion Snoop. And I just want to go back to WGSN and Fashion Snoop. To be like a full-fledged member of these groups is probably like $5,000 a month. And they are so generous in not selling you anything when you come to their trend forecasting. And of course, it's a lot of information to take in, and it's a lot of information to digest. But one word of advice when it comes to these trend forecasters: at the end of the day, all the advice that they give you, you have to be able to take it, kind of like digest it, and then understand what works for your customer. So if they say like neon florals are in and you know your customer is never going to wear a neon, how do we interpret that floral trend to something that's sellable in your own store? And this is where we have to really start having that editorial eye and not just what buying what I like. You can't believe the amount of stuff that I buy that I absolutely detest. But if it sells, we're buying it. And that's what makes you a merchant and not running a hobby. So transportation, as promised, I'm going to tell you a little bit about how to get around. There are complimentary shuttle services. I absolutely love taking them because this is where you're forced to sit next to somebody you don't know. And hopefully, even if you go with people in your team, you sit next to somebody that you don't know, because these are the friendships and the conversations that you get to develop at the trade shows. There's taxis that will take you everywhere. There's Lyft, there's Uber. And of course, if you're brave enough to even want to rent a car and park, there is parking all around the areas and by the convention centers too. So the Digital Soul Planner, exactly where you're going to go to look for the workshops. That is your online, your laptop web planner. You're going to find all the new exhibitors. You can map out all the details of the shows. And just take into account, there are actually 12 shows. And each one of those shows has a neighborhood and has different price points. So it's really important just to get like a heads up and make a plan. Even though I want to tell you the truth, ready? I do this every year. And for the 51st time, I'm going to be guilty of throwing it all out the window when I get there. But the idea is, in my subconscious, it's still that master plan of what I needed to get is still there. Take notes, take advantage of all the planners, and most specifically write down the times and the locations. Make sure that you have the right locations of where the seminars are being held. So there also is a retail concierge service. And I remember when Celeste first told me about this, I was like, what are you kidding me? That's like the most insane thing I've ever heard of. Like, no trade show does this. But you can literally email or call, and it's on your screen, and don't forget, these slides are going to be available to you. If it's available, you will email them and say, I'm looking for this very, very specific item, and they will tell you not only the brands that carry it, but where those brands are located. So this is like having a personal assistant, they call it the concierge, but this is like having your personal assistant to help you guide through all the stuff that you may or may not understand, or you just want something or have a very specific need. So pre-show prep. It's not on one of these slides, but I am not joking about, you know, if you live in a community where you hop in your car, you go to work, and you hop back in your car, and you go home, and you don't do a lot of walking like we do in New York, and even though the weather has been dreadful, it's like minus 10 degrees, nobody's really walking today, or yesterday, or actually for the whole week, it is important to get your training on. Register early. So if you haven't registered, it is important because the lines to register at that show are enormous, and you don't want to be disappointed if you end up being rejected or having to pay because you didn't have the proper credentials with you. And this is my own personal pet peeve. We are in the fashion industry, and you know, sometimes when I give a lecture and I'm looking down at the audience, some people look like literally a homeless person on laundry day. And when I ask them, like, what were you thinking when you wore these, like, baggy sweatpants and scuffy sneakers, even though I must say that is a trend now, so I'm going to put that one aside for the time being. But like even like a nondescript, overwashed, faded T-shirt, the answer is, oh, I wanted to be comfortable. But you know what's going to happen? These are the same people that wanted to get that appointment with an important brand that they're not going to pay attention to you because, unlike they told you in grammar school, people are judged like a book and its cover. So we are in the fashion industry. I expect everybody to look like they're in the fashion industry. And again, you don't have to wear every single trend. So like, oh my God, look, she's a trend, you know, walking trend report, even though I rather that than the sloppy, you know, unkept look. But again, the more professional you look, the more likely people are to take you seriously, and especially when you're starting out. So it's all about the image, right? Especially with our stars and with ourselves. Bring a notebook and a little stapler, because not everything that you see you want to buy instantly. And, you know, I've made the mistake, too, of just, like, throwing cards into my bag. And when I get home, I have no idea what they belong to. Another trick that I like to do is when I get to a booth, I always ask, because you will not get into more trouble. It's like corporate espionage, which is really a thing, taking random pictures of items. But when possible, if it's something I'm not going to buy, I will ask. And what I'll do is I'll take a picture of the card, I'll take a picture of the booth, and maybe even the salesperson, because that's how I associate things, and then I'll take a couple of pictures of the things that I like so that I can go back and make that assessment. And it's funny because the minute that I see a new product, I'm like, oh, that's nothing I'll sell. That's when I'll get like three people in the shop that will say, oh, do you have that? I'm like, really? Darn it. Here's my note. Don't bring a large bag, and especially one of those giant like roller bags that everybody's going to trip over. And again, to me, that just shows that you are new to the, and you don't want a big giant sign on your forehead that says, I'm really new, so please don't pay any attention to me. So only really new buyers insist on carrying all the catalogs and all the line sheets that they could possibly bring back home with them. And you know what's going to happen to all that mountain of papers that you're going to bring back? You're going to make a pile and you're going to set it on fire because you will not remember what was what. So having them send you the digital, writing the notes, or better when we get to the next part, writing the orders at the show is more important. Don't forget to bring your laptop. Don't forget to make notes on your best brands, even setting an open to buy. Ask the customers in your store. You know, we have a couple of clients that take their top 10 customers out to lunch, and they have a big discussion. And you know what? They've reported back saying that when they do that and they buy something that's not normal or typical or a brand that's not that is new to the store, whoever suggested it becomes like the advocate of that brand. They put it on their social media, they put it on their Facebook, and they want to make sure that they weren't the one that made a mistake in something. So it's really funny when we talk about these influencers, you know, like your Beyonce's and your Rihanna's, when it comes down to it, it's really like you know, Mary Main Street. She has a circle of friends and she's their tribal leader. And whatever she wore to church or to an event or to a graduation, everybody kind of maps out what she's doing too. So find out who your Mary is and make her your fiance. And if you are a new start, it is really important that you bring something with you, pictures of the store. I call it like a glamorized snapbook of your scrapbook of your business idea. Because when you have a tangible, and again, with some of these brands, they don't want to necessarily sell a brand new store if they think that you don't know what you're doing. So if you could show them pictures, and of course, it's not going to be pictures of your store, you're not open yet, but ideas and concepts like, I'm a little bit of an Anthropology meets Ralph Lauren home with, you know, this kind of price point, and this is my wish list brands, and they know that you know what you're talking about. More likely, be receptive to selling you as a new store. So it is important to get all that feedback, make your list, check it twice, almost like Santa Claus, and take risks. But now I'm talking to the stores that have been in business for a little bit, and it might be your first time at Magic. I know that it's so easy to get into the routine of buying over and over and over what's selling because we're selling it and we're making money. But it is so important to always leave a little budget or add to your budget for new brands, for a new trend, for something international, for something unexpected. And, you know, I just want to even quote Diana Vreeland, who was the editor and probably the most avant-garde of all the Vogue editors back in the 60s, she said, you have to give the customer what they didn't know they wanted. So just think of yourself, like, I remember I have a favorite story about Anthropology that I walked in, I was literally looking for a cardigan to go to Magic because it is oppressively hot in the summertime and oppressively cold inside the convention center, and you'll find the same time now in the winter. It's quite chilly outside, but even colder inside the convention center. I go to Anthropology looking for like this little cardigan, and I walk out with a tea cozy. You know what a tea cozy is? I didn't know what a tea cozy is. It's this thing that you put over your teapot to keep it warm, but it was so darn adorable that I actually had to buy a teapot to put on my tea cozy. So that's the perfect example of buying something that you didn't expect, but you needed and you wanted at that moment. So during the show, familiarize yourself with the retail lingo. And again, there's not like a handbook or a workshop or anything, but understand what a cancel date is and an FOB point, which means that where you're paying the shipping from, especially with the internationals, you want to know if it's a landed price here in the U.S. that they're shipping you from the U.S. or if you're paying duties and fees and shipping from Brazil. So those are kind of the things that you want to know. Everybody has their own buying style. You know, I talk about one of my first clients, you know, 20 years ago, that she still will walk the whole show, go back the next day and take notes, and on the third day, she will write the order. Me, I'm a one-hit Nelly. I come in, I see it, I write it, I buy it, I place the orders, but I always mark it, hold for confirmation. Because now I want to be able to go back, look at my pictures, look at my budget. I want this now, I want this later, I want this in 6 weeks, and kind of work it out, and then I confirm the orders. And you know what the best part is? You don't have to confirm every order that you write a note on. And it's okay to eliminate it. And I even write notes like, why didn't I place this order? Oh, because the guy was a jerk and somebody else had it and they were nicer. That is an honest, valid reason to buy something. And I'll tell you, if they were a jerk at the show, if you have a problem with a return or something, they're probably going to be more jerky at that stage. And as a buyer, it's very important to understand that costing that we talked about, but don't buy product because of price or because of a brand. Like, actually look at it as a commodity. And I like to teach my buyers to look at something, price it in your head, like, oh, my customer is going to pay this for that, and then ask what the price is and see how far away I am. Sometimes we have to walk away. Sometimes it's negotiable. Sometimes I'm actually very surprised that I can get like a really nice margin. And most importantly, don't forget this. You are the buyer. Do not let anybody sell you. If your gut tells you this is not right for the store, if you have to buy one more thing to meet the minimum, and I'm going to say about those minimums, we buy it to be polite because we feel like we have to meet the minimum. But you know what's more important? For you to be the boss and say, you know what? I know your minimum is $500, but I'm at $450. I think it's okay if we just work this out because this is what I'm comfortable with and I don't want to buy anything else. And most likely than not, they'll say, yes, that's fine. So there's also a big cycle of life when it comes to buying, and that's on the other side of the slide here, is when to buy and how much. So right now, when we go into the show in February, we're previewing fall. Fall that's going to start delivering in August, September, and October, and some winter goods you might get in October, November, and then you'll also get your holiday. So that's all the deliveries that we are anticipating at this time. I probably will place 45% of my budget for those months' delivery. And of course, don't write your order where it says start at the beginning of September and end at the end of November, because you can't control your bodies, your styling, your price point, and your merchandising if you have such a big open delivery. So I always try to do it by month and give myself at least a four-week window for a start ship and a cancel date. I'm also buying in season. That means I'm buying like what's available right now, what's available, you know, for Easter and Passover. And I'm also buying immediate. What do you have that's already discounted? What have I sold very well these last couple of months that I would like to buy back into, but I know I'm going to have to mark down because winter is ending. Like, you know what's a really great thing to buy right now at discount? Gloves. Everybody and their mother has lost a pair of gloves. They have lost one glove. They left it in a taxi. They left it at somebody's house. And there is no place on that this God's green earth to buy a pair of gloves that it's not on Amazon or at a boutique environment. And now, because they're probably discounted, you can sell it at the same price. And when you do have to mark it down, you're actually still making money on it. So those are your margin builders that you want to think about and plan for. So, ready? This is kind of like the order of operation when I teach buying that I like to do. The first thing I do is I look at the collection. I don't want to sit down. I don't want people showing me things one by one. I want to be able to thumb through it. And as a new buyer, please always do ask for permission to do that. So I look at the collection, and now in my mind, I start pricing it. Oh, I could get $50 for this dress. This pair of jeans can go $100. I love the weight of this cashmere sweater. I'm going to go $450 on that one. And now you ask, can you give me an idea of price points? And what's really exciting about this is that sometimes it's all over the place. And then they'll tell you like some crazy story like, oh, this is not your normal cashmere. This is by a sacred goat that lives in the mountains of Tibet that only once a year the monks can hand comb the fibers off of this goat and loom it by elves in the full moon. And you're like, whoa, that's a really great story. Nobody's paying $10,000 for this sweater. We need to move on. So understanding pricing and what your customers, and this is the technical word that we use, consumer price resistances, is incredibly important. Now you want to be able to control when you're getting the goods in. What is your cancel date, which legally means the last possible date they can ship you before you can cancel an order. Because once you place an order, technically it's a legal contract. So if you break that contract, they could actually chase you for that money. I don't think that really happens, but what happens, and to me it's worse than being chased for money, is that they blackball you. And they know you as a buyer that's not serious, that didn't calculate their budget, and that cancels orders. So you may not also get the goods when you wanted them, or they might sell it to somebody else if they're short on goods because they know that you're not dependable and reliable and that you cancel your orders after they've been placed. A start date is the first day that they can start shipping you. So usually, like I said, I like to keep it between 2 weeks to 30 days in a window of opportunity. But if I'm buying things that merchandise together, I might say ship it as one shipment, which is really important, especially with the young contemporaries. They'll send you a box every single day, and that's where you spend so much money on shipping. So they are consolidated, or if you're doing things in groups and sets, I'll do that too and bracket them on my order. So what are your terms? This is a very polite way of saying, how am I paying for the goods? As a new store, it's going to be on credit card terms. And again, I really emphasize this. Do not give your credit card at the show. They will charge your credit card. Do not write down your credit card number. And if they say anything like, oh, we have to take the credit card, if not, we can't process the order, yeah, that's the point. I don't want you to process the order. I want to have time to go home, look at it, look at the pictures, talk to the team members, see what we like, what we don't like, what we found somewhere else that was cheaper and better. So all of those things have to be calculated before you can confirm an order and give them their credit card. So where do you ship from is a very nice way of saying what is your FOB, which is the more technical way. FOB stands for freight on board, and it's an old shipping term, but I still like to use it because it's professional. So where are you shipping from? And again, from Brazil, well, do you cover the shipping and duties? No, we don't. Well, then you have to give me a landed price, and that's how you want to do business. Do you have a once goods? This is really important, especially if you're iffy about a brand or the brand's quality, or they didn't have any production samples on the show floor, and they only have, you know, first samples on the show floor. And the difference between the two is production is actually what they've already made and you're shipping or getting shipped. And a first sample or a pre-production sample is just that. Like, usually they're made in a sample house and they don't really fit right, or the fabric might be a little bit off. So that's why you want to ask those questions too. What is your size run and how do they come packed? So again, going back to the contemporary young fashion people, they always pack 2-2-2 or 1-2-2-1. So what does that mean? You're going to get one small, two mediums, two larges, and one extra large. You cannot open pre-packed. You can't say, well, I just want 1-1-1, or I want a small and a medium. It doesn't work that way. Pre-packed or pre-packed. And now when we start going to like Project Women's, where you have more events, or even like the tents where you have like the men's, they'll actually have size runs where you can pick your sizes. And especially when it comes to men's suits or men's pants, there's also lengths that are involved. So you have to pick two lengths. When we're talking about lingerie, there's cup sizes and bra sizes and back sizes. So we have to put that all together and choose our own sizing scale, and that's what it's called. And if I had to err, I always try to buy bigger than smaller. And the reason why is that I can make a size medium small, but I can't make a small size medium. And just think about that customer service that you can offer too. What is your opening order? And if you see, it's almost one of the last questions. So when you walk into a booth and your first question is, hi, my name is Mary, and what's your minimum? You know what you've just said? Mary, you don't know what you're doing, and I'm going to ignore you, or I'm going to just give you a ridiculous number, and I'm going to walk away. So that's really the last question, and it's almost like a polite question, because regardless of what they tell me the minimum is, I'm still buying what I'm comfortable with and having that conversation that we talked about. And of course, we could do a whole day class on just this, negotiation. But an easy way of saying, like, if you really like something but you feel like it's just slightly more than you want to pay for it, or your customer is willing to pay for it, just ask, is that really the best you could do? And they'll say yes or no. And it's as simple as that. Nobody's going to say, oh, look at this woman. I'd rather them say, oh, my God, look at this woman nickel and diming me. You know what that means? I'm doing my job. That is my job, to get the best price. So tips for shopping magic while you're there, start early. I want to stress this. It's a big show. And I know you want to go out and enjoy the nightlife, and I do encourage you that too, but know yourself and pace yourself. I can't tell you, like, so many times, you know, the first day all my buyers that I'm training are fresh. The second day, they start losing their voices. By the third day, they look like the cat from the men. You have to be able to pace yourself, because it costs money to be out here. And that's the other thing too. You can't spend $6,000 on a trip and buy $2,000 worth of goods. Like, you can't fly in first class or business class and stay at the top hotel and go to six shows and lose money gambling. Like, we're not on vacation. We're here to do business. And planning your day and mapping out your day is really important too. Use the show planner, use your app. And here's the most important thing. Even though we have a plan of action, and I kind of alluded to this before, it is so important to walk all the neighborhoods, every single brand, every single row, every single, it says floor by floor, it's only one floor, but every single nook and cranny of the trade show, because you never know what you're going to find. You might find that guy that registered at the very last minute, and they put him over by like the janitor's closet, and you're going to be the only one to have that brand in your store. This is what really makes us the credible expert, understanding the industry at whole and being able to edit it and interpret it down to what we sell in our store. And of course, if you see a busy booth or one of those guys that you've been trying to get into, it's okay to give them a business card. It's okay to get somebody's business card, because now you have a name that you can contact when you get back home and work with them. Network, so important. Some of my really met are not clients, just people that I love and enjoy seeing every time we go to market. I've met there, even sharing rooms, that nice networking, and not with somebody in your town that's going to steal your brands, and none of that goes on. So, and even like we have so many clients that actually live in like colder weather, and instead of marking down something that's a commodity, they'll send it down to a friend of theirs that has a similar store in Florida or in Texas or even in the Caribbean. And for those stores that have been in business, make this a priority. You have to see at least 10 new vendors. It is your job. I know the business is good. I know you're making money on the people that you have. I know that you're hesitant and worried about trying somebody new, but this is our job. And even if we don't place the orders and we wait for the next season, or we wait for later in the season when some of our orders have dropped off, which we all know happens, this is your moment of opportunity, and you have these notes already in place. And you know, I always laugh at this comment, wear comfortable shoes. There is not one pair of shoes on that God's green earth that are comfortable after walking all you're going to walk. So my suggestion is I always take two different kinds of shoe. So if I take a low heel, I'll take a higher heel. Or if I take a middle heel, I'll take a boot that's completely different so that my foot just has some moment to breathe and to change a little bit. So it's not over until you follow up on your orders. You have to make sure that you get all those digital line sheets that you requested. You want to make sure that you edit the orders that you've written down and you looked at the things that may or may not work for you. You want to be able to confirm the orders that you want to do. And again, you can't take like 3 months to confirm an order. It's usually like a week after the show at maximum. Make sure that you have all your notes of the things that you're not facing organized so that when one fails you or you did very well with something else, I try to organize them by delivery dates, by cancel dates. So if in April I'm selling like hotcakes, yellow dresses, I could go back to the orders that I did in place and see who else had yellow dresses that I could tie into. So make sure, and I'm going to give you one more advice too, because I'm seeing that about 30% of the orders that I'm buying early, like that 45% of my budget for fall, are not getting shipped. They're not getting cut. They sell out too fast. Whatever the case might be. So it's really important to be that squeaky wheel that keeps kind of grinding and whining. How's my order coming? When's my order coming? Are you shipping it all together? Like, this is really part of that whole due diligence that you need to do as a buyer. So this is your retail team of experts. I've been fortunate enough to work with all of them, on Sandy and Celeste and Gail, for many, many years. They are definitely go-to people. Mindy, Drew, Karen, Harry, all of them are just real experts and part of this concierge that, you know, I spoke about a little while ago. So if you're still worried about it or not sure or are going with very little time, use them as your tools and your assistants in this market. This is my information. This is my website, my Instagram. Please do follow me because I do give a lot of hot tips during the trade shows, and this is my book, available on Amazon. It will also be available at the trade show, and I think that you'll find like this very funny guide of all these wonderful people I have met over the last 25 years and the lessons and life lessons that you'll learn from them. So thank you very much for your time. Do not forget the mobile app that is available. It's a new tool. It's going to be fantastic, and it's in real life. And most importantly, mark your calendars for the August Magic Show in Vegas. It'll be the 12th through the 24th, and I know a lot of people go on vacation, so you really want to work yourself around that. So we're opening the floor now to some questions.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, Mercedes. As always, really fun. I love hearing all of the stories and all of the cool little tidbits you have for everybody. We do have quite a bit of questions that have come through online. We've answered some, but we've kept some for the end, this part, the Q&A, because we feel it could be applicable for most people on the line. So we're going to start. So question one is, what is the best and fastest way to identify quality vendors that fit your target audience?
Well, so again, I think, so everything is very subjective, right? We're talking about different price points and different kind of scalability of different manufacturers. So I feel that it's really important to ask when you're at the booth, is this a production sample, like from your production factory, or is this from a sample house, or from a, you know, a, yeah, from a sample house, or your first sample? When you look at production, it should give you the end game of what the quality is actually going to be like. And again, don't look at price point, because you'll be really surprised at some of these inexpensive brands that have superior quality. And, you know, I love when people like bashing like Zara and H&M, like it's cheap stuff. No, it's not. It's actually really darn good for the prices that we're paying.
Great. Next question is, what quantities do I need to order for private label?
So this is a fun thing. Private label, so there's two forms of private label. When we go into sourcing and we product develop a private label, usually the minimums are around 300 pieces, and that's mostly for wholesale. When we're doing private label for our own store, nobody's going to put your own brand into the store. And you also want to note, the brand that you put in your private label clothing shouldn't be the name of your store. You want to be able to make a different brand up. And just because of the case of Anthropologie, where you might want to grow it out of your own business or even sell it, or in the case of really bad quality, you don't want it to be associated with your store. So what I do is, and this is kind of just like very like low tech, we take the labels out and we sew our labels in. And usually we can find like a local tailor or a seamstress or somebody that works from home to do it for us. And usually we pay between the label and the sewing and the taking out about $1 for each one. That dollar could be 30% more that you're adding on to the cost of your goods.
Great. Another question that came in regarding manufacturing. Am I able to find manufacturing for my shirt line at sourcing? If so, should I bring a sample shirt with me?
Oh my gosh, yes. That's what sourcing is all about. So the forms of communication, you know, it used to be so complicated, right? But now if you bring a sample of what you like, and even if it has corrections like, oh, I want the collar to be a little wider, or I want the buttons to be made out of shell, whatever it is, whatever changes you need to make, and you can articulate that while you're there in live person, you'll get that sample very quick, because what they do is they reverse engineer it. So don't expect your sample back, because they have to actually tear it apart, open it, make a pattern, and restyle it for you. But yes, absolutely, that's the best way to work.
Perfect. Another question that came through is, how long do you suggest we schedule an appointment for? So per appointment, how long would you suggest it usually on average would be?
Well, you know, it's funny because if you're really very new to buying, I would say take your time and just go through it and ask all your questions. But, you know, because it's a big show and because I have the luxury, or we all have the luxury of finalizing our orders later, I just take as many notes as I can. Sometimes I don't actually write it all down. What I do is I'll take their line sheet, circle, and make my notes on each of the products, and then I type them into my computer system later. But I would say that on average, you would probably spend about 15 minutes in each of the booths when you're writing an order. When you're looking through things, it probably takes you like a minute and a half.
Great. And here's a related question from a first-time Magic attendee. Why do we need to make appointments with vendors?
Well, some of the big brands, like, you know, especially the denim guys or the contemporary guys, they probably bring like 6 or 7 salespeople with them that have literally half-hour back-to-back appointments from 8 in the morning until the show closes. So I don't want you to go all the way out to Las Vegas if these were the only brands that you were going to see and be disappointed that you're not going to be able to see anything. And again, some of these bigger booths, more important brands, they're very cautious about who comes into the booth, who could actually look at the product, especially if they don't know you, and especially if you're a new store, there's no way you're going to even touch one of their samples.
Cool. Another question is around accessories. I'm looking for accessories. Is there a separate section for those items?
So, interesting enough, I feel like every single part of this show has a group of accessories. You'll find And, you know, even going back to like young contemporary, you'll find footwear there too. You'll find bags, you'll find necklaces and sunglasses. There's a really wonderful umbrella vendor. So they're really kind of scattered throughout the whole show.
Great. Another question. Can you explain a little more about buying and ordering? Do you fill it out with them, hold for confirmation so you can place it later, or through email and phone?
So
buying and ordering.
So it's really hard to – I'm going to do my best to explain the process. But there's so many variations of it, but I'll just tell you what I'm comfortable with. So again, going back to lack of time, I do use my own order forms, and I don't like people to write my orders because I like to put my own descriptions of product. And it's a very simple thing because they can substitute something, and if it's not written correctly on your order, cancellation dates, the way you want it delivered, ship as one shipment, do you want back orders, like all of these things have to be kind of spelled out because it is a legal contract. So if I'm pressed for time, I will just circle the things that I want and I write my orders on my QuickBooks system and I email it to them. If I'm working with the fast fashion people, you know, they have amazing technology where they can scan all the things that I want. They usually put like one pack or one pre-pack per item. It adds it up for me. It even gives you a little picture of the item, but I'll take that back with me and then confirm it when I get home too. So there's a lot of different ways, but my most important takeaway for you is that if I'm handwriting an order at the show, I do it on my own order form and I mark everything hold for confirmation. Now, in anticipation of your next question, if you don't have your own order forms, use theirs just to kind of get the gist of your order. But definitely put them on an Excel sheet and email it to them, because you want to work on your terms and not necessarily on the terms of the vendors.
Great. So a couple of questions have come through about taking pictures. So one question was, can you take pictures of the product? And then another question was, what's the best system for taking pictures and attaching to orders so when you get back you have a better visual of what you have ordered?
So, you know, it's funny because I even bought one of these, like, Japanese Nikons where I thought it was going to be so cool and like print every picture and attach it to my thing. It doesn't work, and it was really expensive. So what I do is very simple. When I write my orders, I write it in the same order as I take my pictures. So the first picture is going to be the business card. Second picture is the booth. Third picture is the first item on my order. Second item, third item, fourth item. And if you're not using your cell phone and you're actually using like a real camera, the camera will tell you what number that picture is. So I might even go as far as putting that number next to my description. To answer the first part of that question is you literally cannot. And again, you have to understand that there is so much espionage that goes on in our fashion industry, and the speed to market of copying things is so incredible right now. It's just unbelievably mind-blowing that if you just go around taking random pictures of stuff, somebody's going to get very angry and bring that to your attention. So I wouldn't just randomly do that. And if I'm not buying something, I would ask if it's okay just from my own notes. Sometimes it is, sometimes it's not. And if you ever get a booth that while you're writing notes, they don't let you take pictures and they don't have pictures or a lookbook to offer you, I would walk away, because 100% you're not going to get the things that they're showing you. Either the quality or the colors or the fabrication are going to be completely off, and that's why they don't want any paper trail evidence of it.
Great. Another question came through about where can I get plus size women's clothing? I need sizes 1X to 3X or 14 to 24.
So excellent. So there are, and again, don't be deceived by the names of these areas. Stitch does have some plus sizes. They do go 14 to 24, even though we're finding that size 12 is really important too. And some of the young contemporary guys will go up to a 5X. And while I know that that sounds enormous, Unfortunately, their 5X is mostly like maybe maximum a size 22. So in that case, because nobody in their life wants to wear a 5X, I even advise my clients to take the label out and put like another label, like size 1, 2, 3, or ABC, or apples, bananas, peaches. It doesn't matter as long as it doesn't say 5X.
Cool. Here's a question around sourcing. Do you recommend sourcing for new retailers?
Absolutely, because this is like the most important education that you could get. And even some of the sourcing workshops on like how to get things done and understanding the process and understanding like what's behind the smoke and mirrors and the curtain and looking, because remember, we're buying fall, but they're already sampling spring 2020. So looking, it's like almost having a crystal ball and looking at the future, understanding what's happening, understanding how trend is being translated, understanding the cost. When you actually know what things cost to make, I think that you will be appalled and horrified. And then everybody will want to be a fashion designer too, because there's just incredible margins.
That's funny. If you're just starting your store, what would you suggest would be the best OTB max budget? So it's a new store, and what would you suggest is the best OTB maximum budget?
So there's a horrible, boring exercise that I recommend my new stores to do, and that is to map out your store by product and classification. So, for example, like a boutique, a normal ladies boutique might have four departments. They might have ready to wear, which includes some like what we call date dresses or work dresses or day to night dresses. We have sportswear, which could be activewear or just like weekend loungewear. We have accessories, and then we might have like some home goods, or we might have some, you know, lingerie, like what I said about the bra extenders and things like that. So that's four departments. Now you have to break it down again. I want leggings, I want denims, I want shorts, I want knit pants, I want, you know, woven pants. So all of these things we have to think about, and then think about how many brands you want for each one, and then think about the price points that you want. And at the end of this really long, boring, tedious homework that you're going to wake up in the middle of the night and scream, oh my God, I forgot t-shirts, you're going to have two things, capacity loads and opening inventory, which then we're going to just throw out the window because it was just an exercise. And the math or the rule of thumb is this. You take the usable square footage of your store, and the word usable is really critical because people might rent a 1,000 square foot store, but the actual usable space between the dressing rooms, the back office, the desk, the cash wrap, the dead zones, the windows, might be 400 square feet. So we have to calculate what the sales per square foot projections are, and that's like a whole different math that you need to do. And based on that, what we project we can sell per month. And the rule of thumb, if we're selling $10,000 a month, we need to have three times that amount in retail dollars in inventory. So depending on how much you're marking up, if you're marking up two times, if you're marking up two and a half, if you're marking up three times, that we divide that from the 30,000 that we need, and that gives us our opening inventory budget.
Great. Earlier you mentioned a lot about handwritten notes on site. What about digital line sheets and ordering digitally? What percentage of brands do you think on site are using that tech at the show?
So, you know, as technology advances, our life does get better and faster, which I'm not sure if that means it's better. But you'll see that a lot of the brands will use like websites like Jure or Brand Boom to send you the line sheets, and right on those websites, you'll be able to place your orders. If not, we just take the digital line sheets, and unfortunately, I still love to print them. I know it's not like a good environmental thing, but I like to like stare at them. I like to stare at the pictures I took and kind of put it together before I write it then on an Excel sheet. But yeah, the digital is definitely the way to go because, you know, back then I've been buying since we didn't even have emails. But can you imagine carrying all those line sheets and catalogs and lookbooks with and trying to make heads or tails of it. It's like a ridiculous thing.
So interesting. Speaking of that, someone's asking, so you mentioned not to bring a large tote bag or even a roller bag for a line sheet. What would you suggest we take to carry everything? So all that stuff.
The tiniest bag you can so that you don't carry stuff with you. So I'm being kind of like sarcastic, but usually I do bring like a small bag where I keep my things handy, like, you know, my phone, my wallet, my business card, a pen, and a stapler, and usually my notebooks in the hand. And then on a bigger tote bag, especially if you're a designer and you're sourcing, I'll keep my like my samples, an extra pair of shoes, anything that's like bigger and bulkier. But the idea is that you really want to carry as little as possible. And, you know, this is the other thing, too. When you ship back 25 pounds of paper, it costs a lot of money. So you don't want to be in that thing. You really don't. But now I do carry a folder, which when I write my orders, I will put it in. And you know what's really funny, too? And I just want to mention this. We have this Market Black book that we sell online because a million years ago, I had all my orders in a briefcase. And they stole the briefcase that only had orders at the airport. For 6 months, I couldn't remember what I wrote, who I wrote it with. I'm getting like random invoices. It was a nightmare. So now I have the discipline that as I write the orders, I write down the brand, the name, the PO number, so I have a sequence, so I'm not missing one, like your checkbook register, and the total amount of dollars. So God forbid something gets lost in cyberspace, something physical gets lost, I still have like this one paper trail that I can kind of refer back.
Okay, great. So I have another question here. It's a little lengthy, but okay. I just want to make sure I can go through it. If you cannot get an appointment or look at merchandise, what is suggested to get contact information from the vendor? For example, I'm walking the trade show floor and a booth catches my attention, but it's booked with appointments. What should I do? This is my first show and I don't have a particular vendor that I want to see. However, I'm looking to start my boutique and I want to get an idea of what's available. So they're walking through the booth, they see something that they like, but that booth seems to be packed and everyone's attention is, you know, already with another buyer. What would you suggest?
So this is where you have to put like your big girl panties on, or boys, for those that are listening. And I just walk in like I own the place and I'm like, who's the rep for New Jersey or wherever I'm from? And I take their business card. That's it. And of course you apologize. Oh, I'm really sorry. I don't want to interrupt. Can I just have the rep for California's business card? And they want to get rid of you quickly and they just hand it to you. Once you have a name, you don't know how golden that is. And now you can call up and, you know, even say something. And again, this is like fake it till you make it, right? And I want to just take that saying to the next level. It's not fake it till you make it. It's fake it until you become it. But right now we're becoming that important buyer, that merchant who you're not going to be chasing people's business cards around. They're going to be chasing you to give you your business card. But for today or for next week when we're in Las Vegas, this is what we have to do. Just walk in and get the card and immediately send them an email, even while we're still at the show. Hey, lovely to run into you today, right? She's going to say, oh, my God, where did I run into her? In the bathroom, on the hot dog line, like on the bus, on the shuttle, like where did I run into her? If you can squeeze me in while we're here at the show, I would love to see you. So 50% of the time they'll say, yeah. 50% of the time they'll say, you know what, we're totally booked, but how about we make something when I get back to the showroom? And that's what you want. You have to be persistent, especially with the big brands. You know, I could tell you, like, my favorite, like, I promised my clients I was going to sleep in the booth because they would not give me an appointment. And that was when FUBU first launched. And it was insane. And they had a whole booth, like, sealed up where you couldn't even see, like, what was inside. It was so mad crazy. But I was determined to get, you know, to see the collection. And I did.
Cool. Where can I find more info on OTB calculations?
Well, it's, so open to buy is a really general term. There is math that goes behind it, sales per square foot, rotation of goods, turnovers, units per transaction, conversion rates that make up part of how fast and how much you need to buy. I mean, there's programs and everything that that you could buy. There's specialists like Management One is going to be doing some pretty intensive workshops based on open to buy. So please look that up in the seminar section on the website. But right now, just think of it as a checkbook. You know, you have to have enough goods, especially when you're opening up a store. You don't want the store. I'd rather the store actually look more on the empty side, where you could keep filling in and getting people excited about coming back, than you opening up with like three containers worth of merchandise that don't fit in your store. Because fashion is not like fine wine that gets better with time. It needs to be sold in the season, in the week that it needs to be sold. It can't be hoarded for like next week or next month, or even, you know, some of these retailers will save sweaters that they bought late for the next season. It doesn't work that way. That money could be turning over and making money in your pocket. So to briefly answer that question, which is a lot more than the time I have to share with you today, it's really about just setting a budget, understanding that, you know, you have 100 square feet of hanger space that you need to fill up, and you're buying $20 t-shirts. How many t-shirts does that make to fill up that rack? And start from there. And then work on it. It's a work in progress. And, you know, going back to some of the stores that have been in business and you've been doing well, sometimes instead of buying $40,000 worth of merchandise, let's buy $45,000, because that means that you might be actually able to turn over faster and sell more goods during that time too. So don't just be with these numbers. About turnover, that's important also.
Great. We have another question from a new boutique owner. I know you love new boutique owners.
I love them.
Do POs at the show work like when you order online, in that you are charged when the order ships?
No. So it's, first of all, I want to discourage you from continuing to buy online. I know that there's a lot of very extensive good websites like Fashion Go and LAShowroom.com, and that's fine and dandy, but when you don't know the brand, and especially when you come to the show and you go to that area where those brands are in the young contemporary section, you're going to see a plethora of merchandise that will never end up at that website, because that website really sells commodities and they also add on 50 cents to a dollar more. And this is where a nickel and dime is very important to the bottom line, and that's what we run our businesses on, a nickel and a dime. And then you don't have any profit and all your money's out the window. So when you buy from online or whatever, they do charge your credit card. Here, you give them the credit card once you confirm the order, right before that they ship. And this is how you also control your dollars too. And most important that I want to add is you really want to specify, especially with these guys, to ship as one complete order by delivery day, because if you get a box every day, every time you get a box, it's $7 in shipping. 7 times 50 boxes is a really nice dinner out. So this is how we have to kind of think of our nickels and dimes.
Speaking of, there was a question that came through. Do any vendors take orders on credit? This is another new boutique. They just opened, and they don't have money left over after placing a lot of opening orders. So they're wondering, do vendors take credit?
Well, so I'm going to assume that you are bought out for when you open, for your immediate buys. So when we're buying now, which we're going to be doing in February, when we're buying our September, October, November deliveries, you're not paying for that at the show. You're not paying for that next month. You're not paying that until September. So hopefully you would have already sold the goods that you have, made enough cash and profit from that to put it back into inventory to move forward to the next season. But if you've already maxed out your capacity for cash flow for your opening, I really would evaluate the margins that you have and the turnover that you're going to get in order to make sure that you're going to have a positive cash flow at the end of the season. And I'm glad to hear that you're opening now in the springtime, because I'm in favor of a spring opening over a fall opening, because I feel like you have more longevity with with fashion. You have, starting now in February, you have spring break, then you have Easter, you have Passover, you have Mother's Day, you have graduations, all great months for selling apparel, that you wouldn't have that kind of longevity for fall and winter. And I'll tell you another big surprise for the new boutique owners. Everybody thinks like, oh, December is the best month. It's the worst month on the planet for boutiques because people are buying gifts. And when you buy gifts, you're buying price. So you can't compete when 90% off that Macy has one day sale, you know, closed out before Christmas or Marshalls. That's not your business. You're actually dressing your consumer in November is really our best month in the fall. So she's buying things for Thanksgiving. She's buying gifts for herself. She's buying family, you know, picture opportunities for their holiday pictures. So all of those things come into play mostly in November and not so much in December.
Great. Another question that came through is, what is the best and fastest way to identify quality vendors that fit a particular target audience?
Oh, that question is vague. Like, quality vendors, I'm not really sure. Like, are you asking me, like, how do I know this is going to sell? We don't know if it's going to sell. Is the fit going to be great? Probably not the first couple of guys that you buy from, because we don't know, especially as a new brand, what's going to work for you and not work for you. And it's really important that you understand that your store is always like a work in progress. And that's why I'm really not a fan of new store owners working in the store. And especially when I look at business plans where like they have no employees and they're like, well, I can't really afford an employee. My answer is it's not an option. It's almost like saying, oh, I'm going to open the store without electricity. You would never think that, right? And this is where we have to have like kind of like that boss mentality, that you're not the worker anymore. You're the owner. We have to think like an owner, right? Oh, my God, I almost went into like a Jay-Z song there. But that is the whole thing. And even if you have to wait a little bit longer and open correctly, I would do that. I would absolutely do that. But to answer your question about quality vendors, it's always, and you know what, it's really funny because sometimes I'll see like a new buyer at the show trying everything on in the booth. And I'm like, you know what, if it fits you, it doesn't mean it's going to fit somebody else. And you don't even know if you're looking at production or if you're looking at samples. That doesn't make any sense. And all you're doing is filling time that we don't have when we're at the show. So my advice is just buy a little bit from everybody and try to buy immediate. So if the brand works for you, you could get back into it in season, right? Because we talked about those different delivery dates. And if it doesn't work for you, go ahead, cut your losses, mark it down, kill it, move it out of the store so that you could put those dollars back into something that really does turn over and work well for you. But it's really a game of hit and miss. And I just want to give you an example that always blows everybody's away. Your store is always going to adapt. The way that it started today, it's not going to be that way in a year. It's not going to be that same in 5 years, 10 years, whatever down the road, right? My favorite example of that is Barney's New York. So Barney's, when they first started, was a men's discount store. So can you imagine how they've grown over the years? And, you know, now they're probably one of the leaders that really takes chances on a lot of new, like, higher-end brands.
Great. And a couple of questions that came through kind of going off of some previous questions that were asked earlier. I'm looking to get on net terms with vendors. How do I go about
that? Oh, right. That was the credit one. So here, so it doesn't happen overnight. It's kind of like a long process. One of the things I recommend is to get a Dun & Bradstreet number. And I do warn you because they become kind of like stalkish. Like once you like register on their website and give them some financials, they start stalking with, oh, you need to have a monitoring service and you need to have that. And the law is that they need to tell you when there's a negative or an adverse comment about your credit. So you really don't need any of those extra services. And just because you pay for them doesn't give you like extra brownie points to get better credit. You develop it over time. And then to get your references to build up credit, you know, once you buy a couple of times from a few vendors, you say, hey, listen, this is a small order. Can you give me net 30 terms? So that's pretty much the industry standard. And net 30 means that you cannot ask for additional discounts when you get to pay your bill. And having net 30 terms is great because it almost gives you 60 days because after the 30 days, I still pay with my credit card. And if you hit it just right and you pay on the day that the new cycle starts, you get an extra 30 days. So usually a turnover of goods in the store in a boutique environment is between 3 to 5 weeks. So ideally, you're paying for the goods with the money from the goods you already sold. And that's where you're in positive cash flow with inventory in stock.
Cool. Another question that came through. How do I find manufacturers for my private label? Is there a separate section for them?
Yes, it's called Sourcing at Magic. There's a whole large section of all of that. It's actually, you know, it's really quite fun. And I would take definitely some of the workshops. I always hate to plug myself, but it's a darn good workshop on Wednesday. No, that's not true. Wednesday. Wednesday at 5 o'clock, I have a workshop that's called What a Buyer Wants. And we demystify a lot of the process of working with a factory, how to pay them, how to get the right pricing, how to get the deliveries in there. We talk a lot about those really startup kind of questions that you need to answer.
Okay, another question is it too late to buy for spring?
Absolutely not. This is a really, really good time because we've already seen track history. So the brands, and I would say that most of them, and again, trust your gut feeling, will point you in the right direction. So the early spring that just started to ship now, like in the beginning of January, mid-January, they've already gotten reorders. They already know what works and doesn't work, so they can point you in the right directions. There's a lot of in-stock merchandise all the way out probably April delivery. So, yes, it's a perfect time to buy spring.
Hey, another question. How long should a garment sit on the shelf before you mark it down?
So that is an excellent question, and it's an important one, too, because it's always like half a dozen of one or the other, right? I don't like running a multitude of sales every month. If you find that you have something that, you know, after 6 weeks maximum is completely dead and you haven't sold any of it, I would probably move it to the front of the store and put new arrival or spring special 20% off just to kind of move it out. But I only really recommend having 4 sales a year. And usually they're end of the season sales that sometimes we run into a clearance sale. So January is a good example of that. We start the second week with our end of season sale. And then this week we go into our you know how you see ads that say like, and this week take another 90% off. That's what we roll it into our clearance sale. And we just cleaned it up. Get the cash flow because at the end of January, you're going to get all of your spring goods into February. And it's so important to build like this momentum into February because in most parts of the country, February is a horrible, cold, dark month that you have to kind of beg people to come into the store and do like events and promotions and things of that nature. But then it pushes you right into March, April, and May, which is like totally smooth sailing. So that's a little hiccup that you'll run into in February.
Great, and a couple other questions that come through about accessories. We've already kind of addressed it, but accessories can be found and is peppered throughout all of the shows at both locations at the Las Vegas Convention Center and Mandalay Bay. So I just want to make sure because there are a few questions that came through on accessories.
Cool.
Let's see, we have time for just a couple more and a few more flowing in. Okay, I will be launching my store in the coming months. I will be asking the question to the vendors you suggested. However, should I expect the vendors to ask me about my store in return? I know my target audience.
Okay. Oh, there's more to that. Sorry. Go ahead.
You can answer that piece.
So that's why I really prefer that you do like a concept book with, here's the thing with target markets. They vary so much. And, you know, in business school, when I went to business school, everybody like emphasized like demographics. It's not the demographics because you could get you know, a 60-year-old woman that looks amazing in a pair of jeans, and you get a 16-year-old girl that looks terrible. So it's really about the attitude and the mindset of the person. But most important, it's about the consumer experience that you have to kind of differentiate yourself out with. But having a concept book with the wish list of fans, with a little bit of the fantasy and kind of the story behind it, you're also going to create that on your Instagram account and your Facebook account. That's probably what the vendors will look at.
Great. And I think you answered the second part of that, which was, should I bring a lookbook, which is definitely recommended.
Yes.
Another question. This is manufacturing. For manufacturing, what are the rules or U.S. laws on copying other designs? Can a manufacturer copy another company's designs exact, or does it need one or two very small differences? Are there any sort of protections from some other company copying our designs? Do they offer patents in the U.S. for clothing?
Okay, so that is a very easy answer. Ready? Yes, they will copy you. They will copy you exactly. They will even copy your fabrics, and if you're really lucky, they'll even copy your logo. So having said that, you can get Unitarian patents for certain kinds of products. It's a complete waste of time and money, because to defend any patent that you might have on a design apparel, it costs $20,000 every time you want the letter, you know, written from the lawyer, so it serves no purpose. So these are my rules for designers. Either make something so extraordinary that for them to copy it would actually cost them more money, or learn to copy yourself. So have like a diffusion line of your product. And you know, at the end of the day, and I want, if you don't follow this Instagram account, I want you to follow it. It's called Diet Prada, and it just kills me how they like fully like ream out all the designers who are like, oh, this is my new couture collection. And then all of a sudden the next day they'll have like six pictures of everybody doing the same thing. And it's not after the fact, it's way before. Like they'll go like, in 2010, so-and-so did it. And then in 2009, somebody did it. And then in 2000, yesterday, somebody else did it. And you're like, all of a sudden you don't feel so special. But I'm going to give you one more bit of advice. At the end of the day, we actually don't sell pants and skirts and dresses and t-shirts. We sell emotion. We sell fantasy. It's not the t-shirt that I'm putting on. It's how I feel when I put that t-shirt on. So developing the backstory to the product, I think is really important too.
Great, and we have a question from someone saying, can you repeat the name of the Instagram account you just mentioned?
Diet Prada. They're hilarious. And kind of mean too, which makes them more hilarious.
Great. And someone who is joining us and wasn't sure if we already covered this, but wanted to know, if you cannot create a relationship with the vendor at the show, what's the best way to follow up electronically? So what's the best form of electronic communication?
So I would just probably email them, you know, and if it's it's really interesting because if it's a brand that's overseas, in Asia and in some parts of Latin America, it's very popular to use WeChat or WhatsApp for even for like video calls and for sending digital information and lookbooks. So email or WhatsApp or WeChat.
Great. And one more question. As a new private label shoe brand, what scope do I have to wholesale my product to boutique offline retail stores?
So to brick and mortar stores. Wait, I don't understand the question.
As a new private label shoe brand, what scope do I have to wholesale my product to boutique offline retail stores? So brick and mortar.
I don't know what they mean by scope, like what the process is to wholesale to the boutique.
Yeah, that's what I would imagine. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so it's kind of it falls into a couple categories, right? I feel like the first round of sales, first you have to make a list of stores that you want to sell to. Second is I start following them as early as I can, even before I have my first sample, just to kind of get an idea of the price points and their looks and their aesthetics. and the open opportunities that they don't already have in the store or the comp shop. And then I start doing it kind of organically, sending them emails, sending them the line sheet, sending them the lookbook, seeing that they opened it because I'm doing it through a service that will give me reports on who opened it and who didn't open it. And then once I get some traction and, you know, you sell by sending some samples and getting them back, once I get traction in maybe my first or second season and I'm selling 10 or 20 stores, that's when I do my first trade show. So I don't go to a trade show like new, because you kind of get lost in it. But once you have some traction, you have some following, you have your supply chain in place, once you get to these trade shows, you'll also find that some of the reps are also looking for new brands to carry, and that's one more burden off of your back when you're starting a new brand.
Great, and this is a question coming from a boutique. How do you determine your true target market?
Oh boy, this is really funny because again, I go back to like when I went to business school and I have a fancy degree from a fancy school and they tell us all about these things, but you know what the honest truth is? They kind of find you. Like your tribe just happens. And it's really funny because like in my own store, I have like, I want to say like a retiree demographic, but then they come in when they're grandkids and they both shop at the store. So how am I supposed to do like numbers or demographics or target market studies with all of that? But what I try to do is I try to do a broad range of universal looks that fit the trends that are happening at that moment. And then I'm also very conscientious of having several price points that meet those classifications too. So I don't only have like really expensive things or really cheap things. I try to have that good, better, best mix of price points within those categories.
Great. Here's a footwear question. I'd like to introduce shoes in my boutique. Could you give me tips to start, sizes, et cetera? So they want to introduce shoes in their boutique, but they're not quite sure of any like top tips or size recommendations that you might have some advice on.
Oh, excellent. So, and I think this is a really nice add-on. So, again, depending on the price point of your store, like if you're carrying a lot of like the fast fashion and contemporary guys, I would go to that area of the show and just really pick like just what we call bestsellers, right? So right now, you know, in footwear talk, people are really talking about transparency, like clear sneakers or sandals that are clear to wear with those little like ankle socks that are really colorful and full of sequins and all kinds of details and like tattoo prints. So if I had to buy one, I would probably start at that opening price point and see how it went. And the other thing that we find too is that when we do outfits in the store, we don't have like a shoe department with like boxes. We keep like one shoe out and we put it underneath the mannequin as part of the display. And then we also offer it when people are trying on a product. We're like, oh, we also got these really cute shoes. So when we're talking about the fast fashion guys, they come in case packs. And usually you could take the size scale of the case pack. They usually come in 12 pairs or in 18 pairs. They might start at size 5 and go to like 9. I prefer a case pack that starts at 6 and goes to 10. Some of them come in half sizes. So that's one of the questions that you have to ask the vendor too. How do they come packed and can I open the case packs and can I actually buy my own size scale? But most likely in the less expensive shoes, which again are really great, they're smart. You know, you could retail them for under $50, get a nice margin of 3 times. You're in and out of them all day. Nobody like comp shops that online because it's such an impulse item that you could have a very nice variety of that. Like, maybe there's another fashion accessory.
Great. And then one of the last questions we have is, if you come to Magic in August, so already talking about August 2019, what season should I be shopping for?
Well, so in February, so again, remember, we're buying more than one season at the same time, right? And if... So in August, we're actually buying summer 2020, spring, summer 2020, but we're also buying immediate fall, winter. We're also buying holiday, and we might be taking a view for resort or cruise. We actually opened back in May. So Basically, you're buying everything all the time, anytime. It just depends on how many deliveries you want, which again, that's what you want always to start to look fresh. So if we're turning over goods every 3 to 5 weeks, you should be buying every 3 to 5 weeks, or at least something coming new every 3 to 5 weeks in the store.
Great, and I think that really that pretty much answers all of the questions that we've seen online. We might still get a few more coming in, but that's the bulk of the questions that we've received. Amazing amount of participation and engagement. So thank you, everyone. If we did not answer your question, we will absolutely send those to our team and even to Mercedes to answer and get back to you.
Yeah, and just FYI, I have some videos, like some Retail 101 videos on YouTube under my company name, Global Purchasing Companies. And follow me on Instagram, Mercedes GPC. And again, we're available. I do a couple of workshops, and I always try to get early to the workshop. So if you want to have a minute to talk to me, and again, even if you want to do something more formal, I'm available for that too. So I'm so excited. I'm so happy that there's so many new retailers. The questions, I feel like, tell me if you don't agree with me, weren't they the smartest group of questions we've had in a long time? Like everybody seemed to be
Amazing.
on point. Yeah, just
I
lovely.
loved
It
it.
refreshes my soul. Thank you so much for that.
Absolutely. Thank you, everyone. We really appreciate your time. And Mercedes, thank you so much for being amazing as usual and giving us such honest, real, insightful tips and tricks that every retailer can take now, future, online, brick and mortar. Just amazing amount of engagement today. So I want to thank everyone. Again, a recording will be made available within 24 hours. So by tomorrow afternoon, you will receive a recording along with some other tidbits on Magic Show. And have a wonderful rest of the week, and we're really excited to see you at Magic.
Yep, see you in Vegas.
Thank you.
All right, I'm going to sign off now. I feel kind of
Sounds
bad though,
great.
but goodbye.
Bye, everyone.